A very good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindi News Analysis by Shankara AS Academy for the date 9th of May 2021. These are the list of news articles taken for today's discussion. It has been provided along with the page numbers of these news articles in different editions of Hindi newspaper. So now let us move on to our first session, which is based on previous year prelims questions. In this segment, we will see the prelims questions that appeared in UPSC Civil Services Preliminary Examination 2020. And today we will see four questions. Now let's take up this first question. It asks, with reference to the history of India, Ulgulan or the Great Tumult is the description of which of the following events? The revolt of 1857, the Mappila Rebellion of 1921, the Indigo Revolt of 1859-60, Birsa Munda's Revolt of 1899-1900. See, as you can see, the question is about Ulgulan or the Great Tumult. See, tumult means agitation. See, Ulgulan is a movement led by Birsa Munda, and this happened in the present-day Jharkhand and Bihar. Birsa Munda was a celebrated Adivasi freedom fighter. He represented grassroots leadership in the struggle against British colonial rule. And this term Ulgulan was used to refer the movement or the uprising which was led by him. And this term means total revolt. Now, the center of Birsa Munda's Ulgulan was the Kunti district of Jharkhand. So, he fought the British somewhere between 1895 to 1900s. So, the correct answer to this question is option D, Birsa Munda's revolt of 1899 to 1900s. So, taking this opportunity, let us also discuss certain facts about the movement Ulgulan. This movement was aimed at reforming the tribal society of Mundas. It involved a social side and also a political side. Now, under the social side, Mundas were urged to give up drinking liquor, to clean their villages and to stop believing in witchcraft and sorcery. Here, Birsa believed that the outside forces such as missionaries and Hindu landlords were ruining the Munda's way of life. So in the year 1895, as a part of the movement, Birsa urged his followers to retrieve back their old life. And this life involved earning their living through tapping natural springs, planting trees and orchards, and practicing cultivation. So this was the social side of this movement. Now next comes the political aim of this movement, which is very important from exam perspective. Now this aim was to drive out missionaries, that is the Christian missionaries, money lenders, then Hindu landlords and the British government. After driving out these outside forces, the political aim was to set up a Munda Raj under the leadership of Birsa Munda. It is because the movement identified all these forces as the cause of the misery that was suffered by the Munda tribe. For example, British destroyed Munda's traditional land system through their land policies, and the Christian missionaries were criticizing Munda's traditional culture. So like this, every one of these external forces were suppressing the Mundas. But when the movement started to spread, British officials arrested Birsa in the year 1895 and he was imprisoned for 2 years. So after his release in 1897, Birsa started touring the villages to gather support to his movement. And this expedition of Birsa was a success as his followers began targeting the symbols of Diku and symbols of European power. See here, just note that Dikus were the migrant traders and moneylenders who had settled in their area, and they grabbed Munda's wealth by making the original residents of the area poor. So Dikus were oppressing the Mundas. So remember, the term Dikus is related to this revolt. So as a part of this, Birsa's followers attacked the police stations and churches, and they even raided the property of moneylenders and zamindars. They even raised the white flag as a symbol of Birsa's Raj. But this movement faded out after the death of Birsa in the year 1900s. So this Ulgulan is a significant movement in tribal history, mainly because it forced the colonial government to introduce laws which made it difficult for the Dikus to take the tribal lands. This movement is also important because it was an example of the vigor of tribal people to protest against the injustice and anger against the colonial rule. So that is all about this question, which is based on Ulgulan. Now let's take up this next question. The question asks, the term West Texas Intermediate, sometimes found in news, refers to a grade of crude oil, bullion, rare earth elements, uranium. See, the question is about West Texas Intermediate, and it is a specific grade of crude oil that is light and sweet. It is a light sweet oil because it contains around 0.34% of sulfur, which makes it sweet, and it also has a low density, which is why it is light. I note that West Texas Intermediate, or in short WTI, serves as one of the main global oil benchmarks. That is, it is one of the main three benchmarks in oil pricing, along with the Brent crude and Dubai crude. See, the significance of a benchmark in the oil market is that benchmarks serve as a reference price for buyers and sellers of crude oil. Now, this WTI crude oil is sourced primarily from USA, particularly from the inland Texas. And that is why it is named as West Texas Intermediate. And it is one of the highest quality of oils in the world, which is easy to refine. And remember that WTI is often compared to Brent crude. And this Brent crude is an oil benchmark for 2/3 of the world's oil contracts. And Brent crude is based on the oil which is extracted in the North Sea of Atlantic Ocean. That means the correct answer to this question is option A, crude oil. Now let us take this next question. Now this question asks, with reference to the history of India, the terms Kulyavapa and Dronavapa denote. Option A, measurement of land. Option B, coins of different monetary value. Option C, classification of urban land. Option D, religious rituals. So even though this question is based on history of India, it mainly talks about the Indian economy in the Gupta period. That is the Indian economy under the Guptas. See, in Gupta inscriptions, various types of lands were mentioned. For example, the land that was under cultivation was usually called Kshetra. And the uncultivable land is called as Khila. And then the jungle or forest land is called as Aprahata. And the pastoral land was called as Gopatasara, and the habitable land is called as Vasti. So we can eliminate option C. It is not classification of urban land. Now, along with the classification of types of lands, there were different land measures during the Gupta period in different regions, such as Nivartana, Kulyavapa, and Dronavapa. And these terms related to the land measurements, and they were mainly mentioned in the copper plate inscriptions of Gupta era that were found in Bengal. And according to some sources, Kulya means winnowing basket and Vapa is the act of scattering. Therefore, the word Kulya refers to the measure of seeds and Kulyavapa refers to the area of land that was required to plant the seedlings of paddy seeds of one Kulya in weight. And similarly, Dronavapa indicates the area of land that was required to sow seed grains of the weight one Drona. And that is why the correct answer to this question is option A, measurement of land. Now let us take this next question. It asks, in India, separation of judiciary from executive is enjoined by. Say the term enjoined means encouraged. Option A is the preamble of the constitution. Option B, a directive principle of state policy. Option C, the seventh schedule. Option D, the conventional practice. See, this separation of judiciary from executive is explicitly mentioned in Constitution of India. So it is not a conventional practice. And then if you take option C, it talks about 7th schedule of constitution. As you know, 7th schedule deals with the division of powers between the union and the states. And it contains three lists, that is a union list, state list and concurrent list. So this is also not the correct answer. Now this separation of judiciary from executive is explicitly mentioned in Article 50 of Indian Constitution. It says that the state shall take steps to separate the judiciary from the executive in the public services of the state. And as you know, Article 50 comes under the directive principles of state policy, and DPSP is under the Part 4 of Indian Constitution, which covers from Article 36 to Article 51. And these DPSPs are not justiciable, but they are fundamental in governance of the country. It is the duty of the state to apply these principles in making laws. So that is why the correct answer is option B, directive principles of state policy. So with this, we have come to the end of previous year prelims questions. Now let us move on to the news article discussion session. Our first discussion is based on this news article, which covers the explosion that happened at the limestone quarry in the Kadapa district of Andhra Pradesh. This accident took place when gelatin sticks were being unloaded from a truck. See, note that these gelatin sticks are cheap explosive materials and they are used by industries for the purposes of mining and construction related works. And due to this accident, nearly 10 workers were killed and the investigations are in process to find the reasons behind this accident. Now, we have taken up this news article because if you see the previous year questions, you can note that UPSC highly focuses on minerals, its distribution, etc. So, today let us focus on the mineral limestone. The syllabus relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. See, limestone is a sedimentary rock. As you know, sedimentary rocks are formed as a result of deposition, accumulation, and concentration of minerals in the horizontal strata. See, it is composed mainly of calcium carbonate in the form of mineral calcite, or also it is composed of calcium and magnesium carbonates. You should note that calcite is the most common form of natural calcium carbonate. Now, this limestone is a non-metallic mineral that does not contain metals. and know that about 10% of the sedimentary rocks are limestone. Now, the two most important constituents of limestone are calcite and dolomite. Now, one important feature of limestone is that when it is altered by dynamic metamorphism, it becomes coarsely crystalline, and this form is referred to as marble and crystalline limestone. But however, the limestone which is used by industries in bulk quantity is a bedded type of sedimentary limestone. So what are the uses of these limestones? See, limestone is the basic raw material for the cement industry. As you know, cement is a substance used in the construction that sets, hardens and adheres to other materials. And the cement used in the construction is usually inorganic and it is often lime or calcium silicate based. Then limestone has also applications in the iron and steel industry, as limestone is used both in the blast furnaces and also in the steel melting shops as chemical agents, because limestone is essential for smelting iron ore in the blast furnace. Then it also has applications in the glass industry, because the glass industry requires high calcium limestone and combined calcium carbonate and magnesium carbonate for producing colorless glasses. Then it also has applications in sugar industry, as lime is used for clarification of cane and beet juice. That is, lime is used for the purposes of removing the impurities from the juice and also for precipitating sugar from impurities. Then apart from this, limestone is also used as a carrier in the manufacture of calcium ammonium nitrate fertilizer. So these are the areas where limestone has its applications. And as you can see, limestone has a widespread application in majority of our industries. So now let us know about the limestone reserves in India. As per the National Mineral Inventory Database, the total reserves of limestone of all categories and grades has been estimated at more than 2 lakh million tons. And as per this database, Karnataka is the leading state, having 27% of total resources. It is followed by Andhra Pradesh and Rajasthan. Both have 12% of the total reserves each. And then Gujarat holds 10%, whereas Meghalaya constitutes 9% of the total reserves. Then Telangana holds 8%, and Chhattisgarh and Madhya Pradesh holds 5% each. Then the remaining 12% of the limestone reserves are shared by other states. Now next is the production of limestone. As per the National Mineral Inventory Database, the production of limestone in the year 2018-19 was at 379 million tons. The database also notes that the production has increased marginally by about 11.34% as compared to that of the previous year. And here you should note that about 97% of the total production of limestone during 2018-19 period was of cement grade, and the remaining 3% was other grades. And as per this database, Rajasthan was the leading producer state that accounted for 20% of the total production of limestone. It is followed by Madhya Pradesh and Andhra Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Karnataka and Telangana. All of these states contribute to around 8% to 13% limestone production each. So these are the facts that you need to know about limestone. Now let's move on to the next discussion. This discussion is based on this FAQ article, which talks about the 102nd Constitutional Amendment Act. See, if you remember, recently, in its judgment, Supreme Court nullified the Marathas reservation, and we have discussed about this on our 6th May in the news analysis. Now, while delivering this judgment, Supreme Court also talked about another aspect which has created a question on the federal powers. Supreme Court has talked about the powers of the state on modifying the backward classes list. We know that this right of the state has been infringed upon, as pointed out by many. So in this discussion, let us see what is the issue, what was Supreme Court's say in it, and how it justifies its judgment. The syllabus relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. First, let us know what the court said before we understand the issue better. See, Supreme Court, by a 3-2 majority, ruled that after the passage of 102nd Constitutional Amendment Act in the year 2018, the states do not have any power to identify socially and educationally backward classes. But on the other hand, the union government argued that it was never its intention to deprive the state governments of their power to identify socially and educationally backward classes. And this assurance was given by the union government even when the 102nd Amendment was given proper consideration before its enactment. But what happened was, Supreme Court interpreted this amendment to the effect that only the president can publish a list of backward classes in relation to each state. Now, you may have a question, what is the relation between the amendment and the socially and educationally backward classes list? First, let us see what is this amendment. This amendment was passed in the year 2018. It was passed after much outcry on the need for an institution that can cater to the well-being of backward classes in our country. So based on this, the Constitutional Amendment Act was enacted and it established the National Commission on Backward Classes by inserting Article 338 capital B to the Indian Constitution. And this National Commission on Backward Classes was set up as a 5-member commission and it was tasked with monitoring safeguards that is provided for social and educational backward classes. And it should also give advice on their socioeconomic development. It can also inquire into complaints and can make recommendations, etc., etc. Like this, it has many other functions. But notably, it was laid down in the constitution that the center and the states shall consult the commission on all policy matters concerning the social and educationally backward classes. So you can imagine the amount of power that was vested with this central institution. Now, apart from creating the National Commission on Backward Classes, the amendment also inserted Article 342A into the Constitution. This article deals with the power of the president to notify particular caste as socially and educationally backward caste. And it also talks about the power of parliament to change the list. See, this is the list which contains the socially and educationally backward classes. And it is also called as the central list. So once the central list is notified, only parliament could make inclusions or exclusions in the list, and that too by law. So we can see that this provision is drafted exactly in the same lines as that of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, because even the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes list can be modified. That is, any caste can be included or excluded only by the parliament. Then in addition to this, the amendment also amended Article 366, which deals with certain definitions. Now, the amendment inserted a Clause 26C, which defined what is social and economically backward. According to this clause, social and economically backward castes, or in short SEBC, means such backward classes that are so deemed under Article 342A for the purposes of this constitution. But we saw that Article 342A only talks about the power of president and the power of parliament regarding the SEBC, but there is no mention of powers of the state government. And that is why it is said that the powers of the state government have been infringed upon. So this was the amendment and the relation to the central list. So now let us see what are the justifications given by the Supreme Court for its ruling that the states do not have any power to identify socially and educationally backward classes. The first justification is that the text that created a National Commission on Backward Classes is very similar to that of the text that created a National Commission for Scheduled Castes and National Commission for Scheduled Tribes. So Supreme Court says that it believed that the parliament in its wisdom has replicated the same provisions, that is for SC and STs, with the backward classes also. A next justification is that a definition clause was added through the amendment, as we saw before, by amending Article 366. And this definition also said that only a class found in the list notified by the president under Article 342A was an SCBC. And that is why Supreme Court held that only when the president says so, a class will be socially and educationally backward. And based on this, Supreme Court argues that it is justified to have a single list with the power vesting only with the center. And one more thing that we must note is that the amendment said that SEBC definition was for the purposes of the constitution. Now, this means that it was to apply to the constitution as a whole, and it includes Article 15 Clause 4 and Article 16 Clause 4. We know that both these articles enable special provisions for the backward classes, including reservation for these classes in the public services. But as you know, these articles are also implemented by the states. So the list mentioned in the amendment has an expansive interpretation and it takes away the state powers that has been granted under Article 15 and 16. And then while justifying the decision, Supreme Court has also quoted that the center had rejected Rajya Sabha's select committee's recommendation. See, earlier when the Amendment Act was still in deliberation stage, the select committee had recommended including a line which said that states would continue to have the power to identify SCBCs. This line was recommended by the select committee. But center rejected this line. So Supreme Court judges came to a conclusion that center had already deliberated regarding the roles of the states and center had rejected the need for state interference in the SCBC list. And that is why having a single list without state powers is justified according to Supreme Court. See, here we should remember one crucial point, which is that While convincing the states to agree to this 102nd Amendment, the center had said that it was never its intention to deprive the states of their powers. Central government even held that the central list was only for the use by the center in reservation for jobs and institutions under the union government, and it will not apply to the states. This was the stand held by the center at that time. But now Supreme Court has a different stand. So we can say that Supreme Court's judgment has created a conflict, and that is why experts view this judgment as a clear violation of the federal spirit of the Constitution. And it also infringes upon the affirmative actions of the state government. See, affirmative action means the positive steps that are taken to increase the representation of women and minorities in the areas of employment, education, etc. And these affirmative actions are tools that are aimed at correcting the historic inequalities that has been prevalent in the Indian social fabric. And the states are better positioned to have the power to correct these inequalities because they have a better cognizance or awareness of the nuances of the society. And that is why we can say that depriving this power to the states, that is the power to correct the inequalities, is not only infringement of federalism, but also it is injustice to the downtrodden sections of the society. Here, the Supreme Court should also keep in mind that one size fits all is not an Indian mantra. And that is why there is a suggestion that center should consider for an amendment of the Constitution where it can include the state's power to modify the SEBC list. So we hope that center will do the needful and this issue will be taken care of. So that is all about this discussion, which was based on the 102nd Amendment and the powers regarding modifying the SEBC list. Now let's move on to the next discussion. Now let us take up this news article, which is from the Sunday's magazine, and it is regarding Somnath Hoare. He is a famed Indian sculptor and printmaker. So in this context, let us take this opportunity to discuss in brief about evolution of art in India and also about Somnath Hoare and his contributions. See, fine arts were seen as European by the British. They felt that Indians lacked training and sensibility to be able to create and appreciate fine arts. So by mid-19th century and late 19th century, art schools were established by British in major cities like Lahore, Calcutta, Bombay and Madras. And these art schools tended to promote traditional Indian crafts and also academic and naturalist art that reflected Victorian tastes. So there was a colonial bias here, and against this, nationalist art emerged in our country. A prime example for this was the Bengal School of Art, which was nurtured by Abanindranath Tagore and E.B. Havel. See, Abanindranath Tagore is the nephew of Rabindranath Tagore. As you know, India's first nationalist art school, which was Kala Bhavana, it was set up in the year 1919, and it was a part of the Vishwa Bharati University in Shantiniketan. And this Vishwa Bharati University was conceptualized by poet Rabindranath Tagore. Now, in the year 1921-22, Nandalal Bose joined the Kala Bhavana. His training was under Abanindranath Tagore, which made him familiar with nationalism in art. And Bose's most creative students were Binod Bihari Mukherjee and Ramkinkar Baij. They often painted the Santal tribe who lived near Shantiniketan, and they made sculptures based on them. Here we should also know about Amrita Shergill. She was half Hungarian and half Indian. She emerged as a unique female artist as she contributed immensely to the modern Indian art through the 1930s. She worked to develop art with Indian themes and images by assimilating miniature and mural traditions of Indian art with European modernism. But soon after Shergill's death, it was a time when India was still under British rule, and India was deeply affected by global events like World War II. And one of the indirect outcomes of World War II was the outbreak of Bengal famine, which ravaged the region and it forced massive rural migration to cities. And this humanitarian crisis compelled many artists to reflect on their role in the society. So seeing the miserable poverty around them and the plight of people in villages and cities, many young artists in Calcutta were drawn to socialism, especially Marxism. And one such individual was Somnath Hoare. He was a political artist of India who found printmaking as a strong medium to express the social concerns. His sketches, sculptures and prints were a reaction to major historical crises. And also they were a reaction to the events of 20th century Bengal, such as Bengal famine of 1943 and the Tebaga movement. So in 1943, he did visual documentation and reporting of Bengal famine for the Communist Party magazine called as Janayuddha. And here you should know about his important graphic print. It was named as Children, which showed the images of children. And this was taken from the experience of the famine of 1943. And these children represent the most vulnerable sections of the society. Now, other than this, some other artworks of Somnath Hoare includes peasants meeting, wounded animal, the child, mother with child, mourners, and the unclad beggar family. So these are some of the points that you should know about evolution of art in India and also about Somnath Hoare. Now let's move on to the next discussion. Our next discussion is based on this news article, which is regarding a recent research done on pangolin scales. See, this study is expected to throw more light on Indian and Chinese pangolins. So in this discussion, let us focus on pangolins. The syllabus relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. See, these pangolins are solitary, primarily nocturnal animals. Nocturnal means active in night. Now, this species is easily recognized by their full armor of scales. They are also called as scaly anteaters because of their preferred diet. Their diet consists of various species of ants and termites. Now, know that there are 8 species of pangolins which are found on 2 continents in the world. And these pangolins are listed as vulnerable to critically endangered in the IUCN Red List. Now, the 4 species living in Africa are black-bellied pangolin, white-bellied pangolin, giant ground pangolin, and Temminx ground pangolin. Now, 4 species are also found in Asia. They are Indian pangolin, Philippine pangolin, Sunda pangolin, and the Chinese pangolin. Now, this species faces many threats as they are among the world's most trafficked mammals. Pangolins are increasingly victims of illegal wildlife crime, mainly in Asia and Africa, and they are trafficked and killed for their meat and also for scales. Their scales are in high demand in the making of traditional East Asian medicines. So this has resulted in an estimated illegal trade that is worth $2.5 billion every year. And this news article also mentions that between 2000 and 2019, an estimate of about nearly 9 lakh pangolins was trafficked globally. And most of them were Asian and African pangolins. And this has led to a drastic decline of the species. This is happening even though all 8 pangolins are protected under national and international laws. Particularly in India also, pangolins are listed in Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. Now, the news is that researchers of Zoological Survey of India have developed tools to distinguish the scales of Indian pangolin and Chinese pangolin. So, in this context, let us see about these 2 species. See, out of the 8 extant species of pangolin, Indian pangolin and Chinese pangolin occur in India. Now, in this, the Indian pangolin is a large anteater and it is covered dorsally by 11 to 13 rows of scale. In this species, the adult male is about 1/3 larger than the female. And one main distinguish between Indian pangolin and Chinese pangolin is that a terminal scale is also present on the ventral side of the tail of Indian pangolin. Ventral side means lower front of the stomach area. Now, this feature is absent in the Chinese pangolin. And note that this species has a sticky tongue, which is longer than its body. It is because it needs longer tongue for reaching and lapping up insects in deep surfaces. Now, this species is found in various types of tropical forests as well as open land, grasslands and degraded habitats. And they are found also in close proximity to the villages. Especially, these species can adapt well to modified habitats, provided that their main preys, that is ants and termites, are abundantly available. Now, with respect to Indian pangolin, you should note that it is widely distributed in India, except the arid region, high Himalayas and the northeastern region. It can be found at elevation up to 2,500 meters. Now, the species also occurs in Bangladesh, Pakistan, Nepal and Sri Lanka. And in India, it is protected under Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act. And it is also protected under Appendix 2 of CITES. And it is listed as endangered in the IUCN Red List. Now, next comes the Chinese pangolin. It is found in the Himalayan foothills in the eastern Nepal, Bhutan, northern India, northeast Bangladesh, and also throughout southern China. Now, this species is adaptable to a wide range of habitats, including primary and secondary tropical forests, limestone and bamboo forests, grasslands, and even agricultural fields. Once upon a time, this species was found in large numbers, but now its population is rapidly declining in its range due to habitat loss and due to rampant poaching for its skin, scales, and meat. See, already the population of this species is limited because they are limited to a certain geographical range and they have low fecundity with just 1 offspring a year. Fecundity means potential for reproduction. So in addition to this, it is also facing pressure due to habitat degradation, and that is why it is prone to local extinction. So this Chinese pangolin is listed in CITES Appendix 2. It is also protected under Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act, and it is categorized as critically endangered in the IUCN Red List. So these are some of the facts that you should know about pangolins, especially Indian and Chinese pangolin. Now let's move on to the next discussion. Our next discussion is based on this news article, which mentions about the India-European Union talks that were held in Portugal. See, India participated in this dialogue virtually. And in this forum, India and European Union agreed to relaunch the free trade negotiations on bilateral trade and investment agreement. In addition to this, both sides also adopted a connectivity partnership document, which outlined the plans to cooperate on digital and infrastructure projects. Then a second tranche for the Pune Metro Rail project was also approved by the European Investment Bank. But beyond all this, India failed to secure the support of European Union regarding the TRIPS waiver in the WTO. Yesterday, we saw that European Union is one of the entities which is opposing the TRIPS waiver. And now India has failed to get its support. So in this context, let us know about what is free trade agreement and what is bilateral trade investment agreement. See, free trade agreement is a pact between two or more nations to reduce barriers in imports and exports among them. Now, under a free trade policy, goods and services can be bought and sold across international borders with little or no government tariffs, quotas, subsidies or prohibitions that will otherwise impede or inhibit the exchange of goods and services. So from this definition, you can infer that the concept of free trade is the opposite of trade protectionism, or it is the opposite of economic isolationism. Now, the main advantage of free trade agreement is that it allows businesses in each country to focus on producing and selling the goods that best use their own resources. And on the other hand, it allows the businesses to import goods that are scarce or that are unavailable domestically. So this mix of local production and foreign trade allows both the economies to experience faster growth. Additionally, consumers' needs are also met. So if you see, free trade expands the diversity and it lowers the prices of goods that is available in a nation. And this will also allow better exploitation of the homegrown resources, knowledge and specialized skills. And the one district, one product, which we discussed on 27th April, is a classic example of this. Because in this one district, one product, we harness the local talent and try to sell it across borders. See, even though free trade agreements have all these advantages, it has one main disadvantage, which is it makes the domestic market prone to fluctuations of externalities. See, for example, if there is an excess or surplus in the global market, it will push the prices down. And this will be beyond Indian government's policy intervention. So Indian government will not be able to carry out any policy interventions to handle this scenario. So this is about FTA. Now let us come to BTIA, that is Broad-Based Trade and Investment Agreement. So it is nothing but a wide-ranging free trade agreement covering goods and services and also investments. Initially, the talks about BTIA was started in 2007 when India and EU began negotiations on a broad-based BTIA, and this held in Brussels of Belgium. Now, these negotiations were in accordance with the commitment made by the political leaders at the 7th India-EU summit that was held in Helsinki in the year 2006. But the talks on this BTIA were suspended in the year 2013 due to the reason that only very little progress was made even after 16 rounds of negotiations. Now, this happened because of the differences that persisted on the market access and free movement of people between both the regions. See, for example, there were many areas of conflict between India and European Union, like the tariffs by Indian products like wine, dairy and automotive parts was not acceptable to EU. And on the other hand, EU's resistance over visas for Indian professionals was an issue to India. So because of this, the talks regarding BTIA was suspended in 2013. So after nearly 4 years, in 2017, finally, efforts were made to renew BTIA. But this was also did not go as anticipated, because at this time, new issues were present, which even complicated the issue. And even many of these issues persist now also. But still, now EU and India are ready to relaunch their negotiations on BTIA. And one of the reasons for this is the China factor. See, this India-EU partnership on FTA negotiations is seen as a response to China's Belt and Road Initiative. And further, EU's negotiation with China did not turn out well regarding their comprehensive agreement on investment. So now EU is looking for market access, and thus it could have acted as an impetus for EU to relaunch the bilateral trade and investment agreement. So let us hope this BTI is successfully concluded after considering all the conflicting areas and resolving the issues. So these are some of the points that you should know about India and EU's free trade agreement. Now let's move on to the next discussion. Now we have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion session. This is a two-statement question. First statement is, Rajasthan is the leading limestone producing state, accounting for 50% of the total production of limestone. Now this statement is incorrect because only half of the statement is correct. It is true that Rajasthan is the leading limestone producing state, but it accounted only for 20% of the total production of limestone. And that is why the statement is incorrect. Now the second statement is, Karnataka is the leading state having more than 25% of the total resources of limestone in India. Now this statement is correct because the total reserves of limestone of all categories and grades has been estimated at 2 lakh million tons. And out of this, Karnataka has 27% of total resources and it is the leading state. So 27% is more than 25%. So this statement is correct. And here the question asks for the correct statement. So the correct answer is option B, 2 only. Now this next question is a direct question. It asks, as a political artist, his sketches, sculptures and prints were a reaction to events of 20th century Bengal. His important artworks include children, peasants meeting, wounded animal, etc. He is option A, Abanindranath Tagore, option B, Nandalal Bose, option C, Binod Bihari Mukherjee, option D, Somnath Hoar. And the correct answer is option D. Now this next question is based on pangolins. First statement is, pangolins are solitary animals exclusively found in Asia. Now this statement is incorrect because we saw that the pangolins are found in two continents, Asia and Africa. And 4 species are found in Africa and 4 species are found in Asia. Now the second statement is, both Indian pangolins and Chinese pangolins are found in India. Now this statement is correct. We saw this during discussion. Now the third statement is, both Indian pangolins and Chinese pangolins are categorized as critically endangered in IUCN Red List. Now this statement is incorrect because as of now, Indian pangolins are listed as endangered. Only the Chinese pangolins are categorized as critically endangered. And here, be careful before answering the question because the question asks for the incorrect statements. And the incorrect statements are statement 1 and 3. Thus, the correct answer is option C, 1 and 3 only. Now let us take two mains question. These two questions are based on GS paper 2. You can answer these questions and post it in the comment section. With this, we come to the end of today's Hindi news analysis and practice questions discussion session. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share. And to subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates related to civil service examination preparation.